On this week's Gadget Show Web TV, John's testing out the HTC Desire. I bring you all the info on the brand new iPhone and run down the best tech to keep you entertained during this year's World Cup. Hello and welcome to this week's Web TV. Right, later on I bring you a rundown of the best ways to enjoy the World Cup this summer. But first, John's got his hands on the latest HTC release, the Desire. Now, he really enjoyed testing the Legend out on Web TV a few weeks ago and couldn't wait to get his hands on the Desire, especially after we heard great things about it around the office. But with new HTC phones in the pipeline, is it still worth delving into the Desire? Or should you hold out for the latest release?
You may recall that a few weeks ago on Web TV I tried out HTC's new Legend and I was very impressed by it, so much so that I was determined to try out their Desire as well, which has actually been around now for a couple of months. Well, I have, and I'm pretty pleased with this too. It's a very fast phone, it's got that 1 GHz Snapdragon processor, and it really makes web browsing a very satisfying experience indeed. And the built-in web browser seems to organise the pages around in front of you very rapidly so that they're very easy to read. It's also got an excellent OLED screen with good definition, and it's pretty responsive to the touch as well. Not quite as responsive as a 3GS, but it does have a very excellent predictive text system which makes typing on the built-in keyboard on screen very easy indeed. And for once on an HTC, you get a pretty good camera, at least in good light. The 5-megapixel images are bright and sharp, and I particularly like the way you can touch on a part of the touch screen and the exposure and focus is adjusted for that part of the picture. The flash is a bit weedy though, it's just a single LED and it doesn't shoot HD video. The screen also helps make video watching a pleasurable experience, and HTC's Sense user interface just seems to get better and better. I like the FriendStream application, which amalgamates all your different social networking feeds and messages into one easily read stream, and I like the Contacts application, which manages to find photos from various other applications of your friends and offers you a wide range of ways to interact with people. And it's this interface plus the combined optical trackball and push button which really gives the Desire an advantage over Google's similar but ill-fated Nexus. Though you do have to watch out, if you have all those social networking functions and everything continuously on in the background, forever updating, you will soon munch through your monthly data allowance, particularly if it's one of those rather measly 500 megabytes a month ones. On the negative side, battery life is arguably even worse than on the Legend. You can really find yourself struggling to get to the end of the day with it. And network reception was rather poor as well. I was using this alongside an old Nokia in the same place, on the same network, and I found the Nokia was getting a very strong signal. This was struggling to get 1 bar, which was really rather disappointing. The FM radio reception isn't actually that brilliant either, although strangely, Wi-Fi reception is quite good. Another irritation is the poor quality of sound from the built-in speaker and the fact that you have to take the back off and take the battery out to get at the memory card slot, which is a bit disappointing. In spite of those negatives, overall, I think the Desire is a very good phone indeed, and it's at least the equal of Apple's iPhone 3GS. Trouble is, as I'm recording this, the new iPhone 4 is expected in a couple of weeks, and on paper at least, it's got a higher specification in some respects than the Desire. And HTC are also expected to come up with higher spec phones soon. So unless you're absolutely desperate for a high-end smartphone right now, it could be best to wait a little while before making your decision.
Time for the news, and it's that time of year again when all you Apple fans have been whipped into a frenzy with the announcement of the new iPhone 4. But with this year's leak of the phone, the announcement wasn't really a surprise. However, Mr. Jobs still managed to bring a few unexpected features to the table. The first being Apple's new video calling service, FaceTime. Now, even though video calling was one of the biggest tech flops in the noughties, Apple still feels brave enough to reopen the market on their new handset. It works using both the front and rear camera, but you do need to be within a Wi-Fi range in order for it to work, and it is limited to the new handsets only. There is an impressive 5-megapixel camera with LED flash, but as well as taking still images, you now have the added functionality of recording HD videos up to 720p at 30 frames per second. You can tap to focus and share your videos with one click, and you can even use that built-in light to get better videos in the dark. And what's more, you can even edit those videos within the device using the new iMovie app. The screen is being dubbed the Retina Display and has a 960 by 640 resolution, and it comes in at 4 times the pixel density of previous iPhone models. They claim it's so high res it's beyond the sweet spot, meaning Apple thinks that you can't get a sharper image on a screen this size. Apple also claimed that the new iPhone is so thin it outslims the competition. At just 9.6mm thick, it's definitely pocket-friendly, and with the new glass and steel redesign, it's as sexy as hell. But don't be deceived by the new slim design, as within the case, it houses a battery with up to 40% extra juice, offering 7 hours worth of 3G talk time, 6 hours if you're browsing over 3G, 10 hours over Wi-Fi, and up to 40 hours of music playback. Gamers won't be disappointed either, with the new 3-axis gyro, accelerometer and compass adding motion sensitivity, making it a rival to the likes of the PS3 controller. The iBooks app has had a bit of a revamp for both the iPhone and the iPad, including a PDF viewer built directly into the app. You can also add in bookmarks and notes to whatever you're reading. But the main bonus of the announcement is that the iPhone 4 will be released quicker than ever, hitting the UK on the 24th of June with pre-orders expected on the 15th. And as there are multiple networks now offering the iPhone, there's bound to be some great upgrade offers available, so make sure you're getting the best deal. And if you want our full impression of the device before you commit to buying, you can be sure that John will bring you a full video review as soon as it's released, right here on this very site. With the World Cup now upon us, football fever is going to grip the nation for the next 30 days. With so many matches to watch, scores to keep on top of, and trying to keep that football fix going even when the final whistle blows, it can be hard to keep on top of it all. But surely there's a way the world of Gadget can help. Over the next month, 32 countries from around the globe will compete for one of sport's most sought-after trophies. And with 64 games to watch, there's plenty to keep up to date with. But what are the best apps, games and tech for you to get the most out of this year's World Cup? Well, first up, we've got FIFA's World Cup 2010 for the Xbox 360 and PS3. If you're lucky enough to have some spare time when you're not watching a match, you could always boot up your 360 or PS3 with a copy of FIFA's World Cup 2010 and have a virtual game for yourself. It includes all 32 finalists and 199 of the teams that took part in the qualifying stages. It has a great selection of modes to play in either single or multiplayer, along with some of the most intuitive and highly addictive gameplay that you just can't put down. FIFA's a great game and it will provide endless hours of entertainment, not only during the tournament, but also for months to come. In at number 4, it's the Telegraph's World Cup 2010 app. If you're after all the latest World Cup news, no matter where you are, then there's no better app than this free option from the Telegraph. Features include World Cup analysis from Michael Owen, Roy Hodgson and Alan Hansen. You can select up to 3 favourite teams that you want to follow throughout the World Cup and get access to them easily through the app's global navigation menu. There's a live match centre including match commentary and game statistics with all fixtures and results, helping you to keep up to date as the tournament progresses through the group stages and knockout stages right through to the World Cup final. So, there's no excuse for you to miss any results. In at number 3, it's BT Vision, which is a great service offering loads of on-demand TV, including the latest movies, TV shows, music videos and much, much more. But it also offers a great selection of sport, including access to ESPN. And in the run-up to the World Cup, BT Vision Sport will be offering over 100 programmes about how each team qualified, a profile on all of the teams and its best players, plus a look at where the games will be played. And not only that, but if you're after that nostalgic feeling, BT Vision also offers some highlights of classic games. From classic England moments in 1966 to heartbreaking penalties, which we're all too familiar with. In at 2, it's FIFA's official World Cup website. If you're looking to get the latest World Cup news straight to your computer, perhaps in-depth coverage of all of the games and the players, then there really is no better place to go than the official World Cup website. The website brings you the latest interviews with some of the best players and managers, full fixture lists for all of the games and where they're being played, full team profiles, and it gives you the chance to comment on all of your favourite moments of the World Cup as it happens. And in at number 1, it's Freeview HD. comes down to it, the most important thing about this year's World Cup, other than England winning, of course, is watching the games. And if you've been unlucky and don't have a ticket to South Africa, then you'll want to watch the games in style. There truly is no better way of watching goal after goal than in crystal clear HD. And with the Freeview HD signal being switched on in 50% of the country, there's never been a better time to delve into the market. So if you already own an HD TV, I highly recommend investing in one of these, a Freeview HD set-top box. This particular model is the Humax HD Fox T2 and will set you back around £170, but there are a number of different models available out there. They work in exactly the same way as your standard set-top box, but plug into your television via HDMI. And if you don't own an HD TV, you could always upgrade. There are a number of manufacturers out there, including LG and Sony, that offer Freeview HD built into their new televisions. But hold on, before you rush out and make your purchase, make sure you check on the Freeview website that you are within the HD signal range. And however you plan on enjoying the World Cup this year, have a good one. And come on, England! Well, that's all we've got time for today, but Web TV will be back at the same time next week. In the meantime, don't forget to check out our website for all the latest news and reviews, and next week we'll be bringing you all the latest from Microsoft, Sony and Nintendo direct from E3 in LA. Bye for now.